Okay. So, she's a dog. That
dog in there. You're listening to the language of dogs.
What is it?
What?
You're not thirsty. You're not touching the water, the orange juice, crab apple. What am I supposed to do? Make you a margarita?
Obedient owners with happy dogs.
I love you.
I love you.
And now your hosts, Justin Silver and Kristin Hartley.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Language of Dogs podcast. This is your boy, Justin Silver, and across the couch is my girl,
Kristin Hartley.
Oh, my God, you nailed it. How are you? We've got beautiful Brutus sitting between us. Welcome, everybody. We're going to be answering your questions on all things dog in just a moment, which you can submit at patreon.com/TLOD. We will answer on this podcast or through live video chats, through DMs over there. You also get early releases of this podcast, video training tutorials, live stream demonstrations, product reviews, copies of the Language of Dogs book, and a percentage of your membership goes to our 501c3 charity, Funny for Fido, that saves shelter dogs. And Patreon's been great. It's a great way to get to know you guys and get to know your dogs and get to know whatever issues you're working through and get a little bit more personalized attention. Because as I say, everything we say here are guides, not gospel. So you take what you want and leave the rest. And it's a lot better when something can be customized to the little specifics. The devil is in the details, and so is the solution with all of this stuff. And if you're digging this podcast, we would appreciate if you give us a 5-paw. Get it?
Oh. Oh, I saw what you did there.
A 5-star rating and review on whatever app you listen to it. The social media is at The Language of Dogs on all social media platforms, Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, YouTube. It's The Language of Dogs for all the training videos. And that's about that. Before we get started, let me just give you some promo codes. I'm going to do one. I'll do one promo code. Darwin's Raw Organic Pet Food. It's got all the organ meats, veggies, minerals that dogs and cats need. It ships frozen to your door in these convenient peel and serve packages. And you can either feed it raw or cook it like I do. That's completely up to you. Everything, these are guides, not gospel. So if you head over to darwinspet.com, hit try it for $14.95. Make sure you enter the promo code TLOD because some people forget to do that and then they don't get the discount. They will send you 10 pounds of it for just $14.95. And they're so cool over there. They don't keep that $14.95. They send that $14.95 to Funny for Fido and we use it to send Darwin's to shelter dogs, which is awesome. So without further ado, oh, you know what? Actually, before we get into the questions, mm-hmm. I want to talk about this heat wave.
Oh, God.
Dogs in the heat.
It's bad. People in the heat. Yeah. Anything in the heat.
It's been a nice 96 with 100% humidity here.
Comfy.
In the Northeast.
Feeling good.
I just posted this video. I was like, hey, here's some tips. The first one I said was get yourself a nice house in the Hamptons with a with a pool boy who's going to just feed you White Claws nonstop. But there are some things you have to be conscious of because when I posted this, some people are like, oh, wait, I never thought of that. Sunscreen.
I love that, especially in the ears.
Baby sunscreen. I like to use baby, and I do it. And when you mean in the ears, she doesn't mean like in the ear canal, but the flops of their ears.
In the folds.
In the folds of the ears, yeah, where the sun's going to hit it. I wouldn't shove it in their ear canal. The tops of like the tops of their heads, especially if they are short coat. I mean, this is more for short coat dogs. The bridge of their nose and on the leather of their nose. And baby's going to be the kind of thing that there's not going to be, you know, you're obviously not going to spray like the Copper Tone Sport in their face or, you know, your dogs are going to go blind.
I don't know.
So don't use that.
You'd be surprised. You never know what people will do.
Nothing surprises me anymore. And then if they have areas of their body, like if they are recovering from something,
if they have scars
or anything like that, yeah, I'll do it over there. For dogs that are like really, really short coats or you can't put sunscreen on them, you could put like a t-shirt, like a white t-shirt over them. Put your hand on the pavement. If it feels like a skillet, get them off of that and get them over into the shade. This is the most important, is the water consumption and how you do it. People don't realize this. When dogs start, if you overwork them, and in this heat, it's very easy to overwork them on even small amounts of exercise. If you overwork them and they're doing that fast pant, the like that crazy fast pant, and then you're like, oh, they're real hot, let me give them a bunch of water, that causes bloat. Bloat is basically the poor man's way of saying it is like their stomach basically flips over and it can kill them.
Oh my God.
Yes. So don't get them to the point where they are breathing like that, where they are panting like that. Try not to. But when you're walking them, when you're out doing activities, instead of if they're panting like that or just any sort of heavy panting, large consumptions of water are no good. So I like smaller, frequent water drinks along the walks. And then when you first come back in the house, or if you've been out and that wasn't possible, a giant bowl of water is not a good idea. But you can give them ice cubes so that while they're calming down to slow their water consumption, and then once they're calmer, let them drink. And you can tell if dogs are dehydrated by their gums. If their gums are white and tacky, that's when they really need to drink. But the most important thing is shorter, more frequent walks and then back inside the air conditioner, because I some of the DMs I get about dogs burning.
Oh, yeah.
Dogs burning their paws on pavement, dogs getting bloat.
Then your dog shouldn't be doing that either.
I don't know if that's the case, because think about it. I don't ever walk barefoot. My dog walks barefoot. But
well, no, I meant in terms of the heat of the pavement.
In terms of the heat.
That's what I meant. In terms of the heat of the pavement, if it hurts your foot to stand on it, then it hurts their foot.
Yeah, I think there is a little bit of give with the pads, but yes, like play it safer than sorry. Who cares? I saw something the other day that made me nuts. I saw some woman had her dog tied up outside of a store.
You've already lost me.
Hold on. I'll tie Bruce up and go get a cup of coffee. If I could see him right through the window.
The majority of the people I see that tie up their dogs are not people that should be tying up their dogs.
Fair enough. Dog was on the, you know, the metal grates, the cellar grates the store. And dog was like tap dancing, like in screen, because he was in the hot sun.
Yeah.
So I grabbed this dog and I went into the store. I'm like, hey, whose dog is this?
Oh, stop and it. You did?
Yeah. I was like, hey, who's our, I was like, your dog's pads are burning on this.
Great.
And you could see the heat waves coming out. Like, I could have fried an egg on that.
Oh my God. And what happened?
Legit. They were like, they thanked me for it.
See, you're lucky because this is New York.
No, it's anybody I would think would be. Actually, I've had encounters where I've like tried to help somebody for something, and then they took a. You know how people are. They take offense. Like, what are you saying? I'm a bad dog parent. I'm like, well, I'm thinking that. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying something else. How's your foster dog doing? You have this. What a cutie!
Oh boy. You know, he's good. He's adorable. He's very sweet.
What's his name again?
His name is Toby.
Toby.
And he is through Near and Far Animal Foundation, which is a great rescue because they rescue domestically and they rescue internationally.
Yeah.
We work in Puerto Rico and Peru and a lot of other places. And for me, it's kind of like having kids. Like, there are people that are like, oh, you have kids. You must love kids. No, not really. Like, I love my kid and I love some of my friends' kids, but I don't just love all children. Okay. And so I work with dogs, but there are certain breeds that are just not my cup of tea. These are not dogs that I would ever own because they're just not a fit for my lifestyle.
Got it.
Like we talked about last week, individualized approach. So Toby is a Chihuahua. And Chihuahuas are not necessarily my cup of tea. And I'm very grateful because one of my...
Wait, he's a long hair.
Dearest friends. Yeah, but he's a Chihuahua.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
I thought he looks like a mix to me.
No.
Oh, really?
He is definitely a Chihuahua.
I could be wrong.
So one of my dearest friends has had Chihuahuas his whole life. He and his husband, they rescue Chihuahuas. And I must send this poor man at least 6 videos a week where I'm like, is this normal? Like, this dog is being really weird or whatever. And he's like, oh, yeah, no, all Chihuahuas are like this. So I'm struggling with, I would like your advice while we're here.
Oh, go ahead.
Let's make this about what I'm going
through.
Let's
make it about you. And then we'll get to everybody else's questions. We got good ones this week.
So he is, and I'm told, and I don't know, so I'm just saying this, I don't know.
Okay.
But I am told that nervous breeds, air quotes, nervous breeds, have certain tendencies or similarities that overlap. So one of the issues we're having with him is that he just pees and poops in the house all the time for what seems like no reason. Let me give you an example.
Okay.
You will take him on a
I've got half an answer
40 minute walk.
Uh-huh.
He will poop on the walk.
Sure.
He will come back in the house.
Yeah.
Within 10 minutes, he shits in the house.
Got it.
So, and then...
Let me take these one at a time?
Same way. Well, it's the same thing with, like, he just literally... this dog now gets walked, because my schedule is very different than my nephew, who's in his early 20s, who's living with us. So he lives different hour because he has like 15-year-old hours, meaning he sleeps all day and stays up playing, I don't know, Fortnite or whatever all night. And then my husband is gone at work all day, and then he doesn't get home till 10 o'clock at night. So between the three of us, this dog gets walked, I'm not joking, 15 times a day. Mm-hmm. And he's still just pooping and peeing in the house no matter what.
Gotcha.
And it's driving us all insane because my son has a thing called sensory processing disorder. Mm-hmm. And especially when the dog poops, if the smell hits my son or if he smells it, he will instantly projectile vomit. So
that
now we
sounds
have
awesome.
Two things.
Oh my
so
God.
That, and so I'm just going to leave it right there. So that's not all the problems.
You've
that's
earned,
just problem
you've
number
earned
one.
Your complaining card on this one.
So that's problem number one. So Justin, why would after 15 walks a day?
Sure.
And monitoring that, I can tell when he's sure. running from the back door to the front door, the back door to the front door, he wants to go out.
Yep.
Like everyone, he has multiple people to service his needs. What's Justin? What's going on there?
How old is he?
About a year and a half.
Who
2 years.
Who had him before you?
Nobody. Street dog.
Someone.
He was a Sato in Puerto Rico. No, we literally plucked him off the street.
So we know his history.
We know his history. He while he was with us, he had an ulcerated cornea, so he had to have an enucleation, which is the fancy term for he had to have his eye removed. And then he also had a prolapsed intestine.
Got it.
And so he
Poor
had
thing.
A very big surgery for that.
Here's what I was going to say.
Okay, hit me.
Okay.
But he's definitely been a street dog his whole life.
Okay. So we know he was a street dog, but we don't know the specifics of his history, mm-hmm. right? I doubt that a Chihuahua would make it just roaming the streets of Puerto Rico. I understand this dog was homeless to a degree, but I'm sure there's people who had, he could live with people and he could have been in the back of a restaurant. I'm like, I doubt it's.
He's been around people, but I don't think he
sure,
had an
I
owner
understand.
In the way that you and I understand what an
I
owner
understand
is.
That, but at the same time, people could have taken him in. It's like, because small breeds, like, how's he going to survive?
No, of course, absolutely.
How would he have survived?
Yeah.
Because the other animals that are homeless, like, that, he's a vulnerable sized dog.
He's very squirrely.
I'm sure he's very squirrely, but he's
very, like,
but
he's
still
got to,
he's still got, I'm sure he is, but he's still got to eat. He's a, ooh, there goes the thunder.
And you there know, goes someone, Brutus. And,
well, he's, these, you know, he's from California, so the sounds of thunder and these water things falling out of the sky are new for him. But we're going to get into fireworks because that's right around the corner, everybody, and someone had a question about this. My point is like this. Here's what I was going to say. I was going to say, if someone else had him before you, who Wee Wee Pad trained him, and I hate Wee Wee Pads. I
there's
mean,
no way this dog was Wee Wee Pad trained.
Okay, but if someone had done that, right, or if he were living in the basement of some, if there was some conditioning, if he was living
outside.
Okay.
Because that's what they do in Puerto Rico.
But this
they
is
treat
what
dog, they just leave him outside.
Well, some people do, some people don't. So I'm saying, here's my point. My point is that if he were prior conditioned to go in the house, then that could be set in motion. So many people I know, they're like, small dog, go on Wee Wee Pads. And it's like, then when they want to break that, they can't break that, or it's difficult. So that's not the case here. However, the process of, you know how I do cycling, and I'm making the video on separation anxiety, which the process of cycling for separation anxiety and for housebreaking is the same. You'd have to go back to cycling crate right outside the house, keep him out there. He has the option of going inside. If they have the option of going inside and you have carpeting and they've already marked on that carpet and they view it that way, you have to sort of reverse that. The only way to really reverse that is by compartmentalizing them in a smaller space, because they're usually, even if they do go in that smaller space like the crate, and the majority of their exercise, you want to go right from that to the place where they are allowed to go. The other thing you can do is you can sop, when he pees, don't sop it up with something. And if you have to, just if someone has like a back deck or a backyard, something that is like right outside that house, right? They pee in the house and then you see them do it and then you go to catch them while they do it. You want to eliminate these variables or make it as narrow as possible. So if he's getting all these walks a day, we don't have to worry about this dog's not just staying in a crate rotting away. That's certainly not the case here. So if you crate him, right, you'd have, who knows if he'll, what, anxieties he'll get from that, but we'll see, right? If you crate him and then you go right from there to the place where you're giving him the option to go, let's say it's, if he's used to peeing on a floor, it could be literally the porch of your house, and you keep a little bit of that urine on there, wipe it up in a paper towel or whatever it is and get it on there, right? So it's got that smell, and just stay out there with him for a little while. And then if he doesn't go, you just continue go on the walk, and then after the walk back into the crate and watering on the walk, so you don't put him in the crate with the full bladder. You want to time your rhythm, time their rhythms of energy and rest with their schedule, but it's in this scenario, it's getting from the crate to out of the house. So you do that as quick as possible.
But why would a dog, if you just pooped on a walk, why would you come back in the house and poop 10 minutes later?
He still had to go. I don't know. I don't know because I don't know him specifically, but it does. The process of training that is irrelevant. Sometimes I'm just like, when people are like, why are they doing this? Why are they doing that? I'm like, what's the difference?
Right, and that's what my friend and his husband were, because they had Chihuahuas forever, and they're like, this is a hallmark of the breed that a lot of Chihuahuas act like this.
Maybe they do. Maybe they. I tend to think this. Like, and I'm not really a breedist. I'm never. I'm the last. I'm the. I am. That's fine.
I believe that there is truth in stereotypes.
There are. There 100% are. But I'm saying I'm the last person who's like these dogs are like this. What I do think is the type of people who have these type of dogs do these type of things and think these things about them, then condition them as such. Because if you think about it, all dogs are made by what? Human beings, and people make them for what? Reasons and preferences and decisions they have. Certain types of people are more geared to certain types of dogs, and you can see sort of inherent characteristics in a lot of those people. This is not everybody. So anybody sitting there rolling their eyes at me right now, it's like, you know what I'm talking about, because if I wasn't specifically talking about Chihuahuas, which you're in love with, and I talked about a type of breed that you're not, you could see the same thing. So spare me the PC crap. But you understand what I'm saying?
Correct.
That's what I think, which is why I'm kind of like, you know, I all my little dogs, love them to death. All my little dog owners, not so crazy about them. Why? Because they're like, because they cut as many corners as possible.
Right.
For the most part. Not
right.
Everybody.
No, it's true.
I have these clients right now. Can I tell you someone I loved? I had this little Pomeranian Peanut, and she was like, I want this dog to learn all the dogs, things that your big dogs learn. I'm like, that's what all my little dogs do.
They all know the same.
And I was like, great. Guess what? I will keep you as a client because I get rid of a lot of them.
That's true. But you did get the one that you kept that I loved was Arthur.
Well, Arthur's like my favorite living thing on the planet. Shh, Brutus. Shh.
But also, he's Arthur.
Like, he's the best.
He's sweet and quirky, and
he's got the best. He's got the biggest personality. I said it the other day. I was like, in my top five dogs
then there's Gustav. You can't not give any love to Gustav.
I'm spending the weekend in the Hamptons. Actually, I'm starting tomorrow. I'm taking Brutus and Gustav to the Hamptons so we can go swimming in the pool.
You're not going to get out of the pool with this heat.
The process of cycling is the way to
do that. All right. So with that,
which it may not be easy or something that you want to do, but that's like, you could also do this. If he's going in a certain spot, you could put the pet, no, it's
different,
all over the house.
It's literally all over the house.
Okay. Sop it up and put it in a place outside that's easy for him.
Got it.
Right? And then you can keep bringing him to that spot, bringing him to that spot, but you gotta, it's the blind spots and the variables. It's when you find it or he's going to do it, and then you got to catch him doing it. That's, you can't control that if he's just running around. So you got to try to nail it down a little bit.
Okay, so we've got baby gates up, and so we just need to expand the baby gatage so that he has even less of the run of the house.
That would be narrow it in.
That's what I meant. Yeah. Sorry. Narrow down what he has access to.
Right, and it may be, listen, this is a very small dog, so it's like, you know, a 5-foot space while he's great. It may be as small as a crate where he's not going to soil. They're going to be less prone to soil.
He doesn't
have
any issues in the kitchen. If we gate him in the kitchen, because the kitchen's not huge.
Oh, well, then there you go.
Then we've been doing that. But the problem is because he also has separation anxiety, which a lot of rescues do,
yes,
as you
they
know.
Do.
But he's especially vocal. And then again with my son, so it's not like where I can just be like, oh, you know, bark it out. Like,
this is not the best foster for you.
It's not. We also didn't know really when we did it. And so kind of every, like, we were like, oh, he'll settle in. And he has gotten a little bit better. The separation anxiety isn't really that big of a deal. The biggest thing that we have is because he's only like 6 pounds, mm-hmm. he's very little. and they're just so fast, like you can't like catch them or any of that. Like they're like little squirrels. And the biggest thing is he's like Velcro
to you.
Like if you sit on a couch, he's like in your face.
Well, one of the
So what happens is if you're walking. So if I get up from the couch, and you've been to my house multiple times. If I get up from the couch and go into the kitchen, which is a very short walk because my house is very small. He will literally walk between your legs as you're walking. And last week he tripped me and I literally fell and hit my head. So like this dog is just on top of every person and he'll dart. So like if my husband and my nephew are home, he's just like, will you love me? Will you love me? Yeah. Will you love? And he just can't like settle.
Well, don't say can't right now or won't
can't
settle
right now.
Now.
Can't, but let me no, tell that's you, what I mean. Can't
I get,
right
I know,
now.
I get what you're saying. But listen, when I explain the things in the separation anxiety video, which we're still editing because it's complicated, mm-hmm. I'm like, here are the signs of separation anxiety. Here are the things that it's not just when you leave the house trailing. Like two magnets
trailing
you around the house and needing to have eyes on you at all times is a lack of autonomy.
God.
A well-balanced dog can go sit and chill by themselves. Doesn't mean they can't sit and cuddle with you on the couch or they're like, you know, they're cold.
Right.
You know what I mean? But what people mistake, there's healthy attachment and unhealthy attachment. Trailing you around the house and needing to be on top of you, all the same, it makes it harder when you're actually going to go out to dinner because think about it, like, you have the momentum of that's been going and going and going all day. So the sit and stay command is the command that teaches them the skill of patience. There's no other way to do that. You know, you can compartmentalize them and then you're doing it in a way where you're manually doing it. But the only way to teach them to process their emotions, which are saying, you're over there, I need to be over there with you, are with commands that teach them to stay put so they can process the voices in their heads, i.e. their instinctual reactions to things. And then learn how to give you space. And sometimes when we're doing the video, you see me doing it. Listen, Brutus, and what I was trying to explain to people in this video, as much of a gem as this dog is, he came with that too. He had some separation issues. When we first created him, he chirps. He goes, it's like, it's the cutest and most endearing heartstring pulling sound,
and that's Toby.
And it was like I was like, oh my god! I did the cycling so early on that it was like I knocked it out quick, and then I was trying to recreate it for the video.
So
but
I
was like,
try to. So I should
you have
try to,
to
definitely
yeah. It's
that.
Just,
the
it's
being like a, with us on the like on the furniture and stuff doesn't bother us in the slightest. It's really more of like the trailing.
Yeah, but
when
here's
you've
the
got you know like 3-4 people living in a small space, like.
But here's the
you're
thing.
Talking about physical danger.
Here's the thing. And this is a hard pill for a lot of people to swallow. If you do training only when it's convenient for you, then what's going to happen is when the inconsistency of that causes habits that are going to be very inconvenient for you. So it has to stay consistent. So I don't give a shit. And I've decided we can say that word on this podcast,
okay.
Right? We can't say other one. I don't give a shit if people are like, you know, I just don't want to go through the process of teaching him to sleep on the floor. He really likes my bed and then he's crying. It's like, you're going to get what you give, right? And I understand, it doesn't mean you can't sleep and cuddle in your dog. You can't have your dog cuddle with you or take naps with you in your bed if separation anxiety is not at a level that's so high. But those things, like you're going to get, they know what they can get away with.
Oh yeah.
They are. They know. So it's like it's not like they're being bad. They're just like, yeah, they're reward seeking animals. You know? And so you have to train them. But we can work on that stuff. Let's get into some of these questions here.
Oh, yes,
okay.
Absolutely.
Boom. We're gonna have to go back and forth with this iPad because I wrote some notes on some of these. I write little one word notes to myself in case I have a little idea.
You're so thorough. Okay. All right, the first one is from Jessica. Hi, I volunteer with a rescue.
Wait. She said hello. Why did you turned her into one of us, a New York? You turned her into
Hi.
A New York. Hi.
All right.
You turned her into
Fine.
One of us.
Hello.
It's okay.
With 2 exclamation points.
That's hello.
Right. With that. Hello.
Hello.
Now Brutus is like wide awake.
We're being obnoxious, sorry.
I volunteer with a rescue, and we have a dog named Autumn that is deaf and scared of new people. But if she knows you, she's a total ham. She was at the shelter a long time, and I recently sent her to foster with a friend. The friend lives in downtown Atlanta. And Autumn is very scared of all the commotion happening outside. Verbal commands and soothing are hard because she is deaf. She is too scared outside to take any treats. She is also too scared to use the bathroom and is holding her pee and her poop in for 24 to 48 hours at a time. She won't go unless she really has to. Our vet is in the loop and watching for any medical issues. Do you have any general advice about training deaf dogs and recommendations for super high value treats? She's not scared of noises, obviously, just all of the people and the things around.
Okay, so yeah, there's a lot here. So
yes,
let me sort of take this, let me take this piecemeal here and go through a bunch of these things. Yes, I've trained dozens of deaf dogs. And the way you train them is you use what you have available. How do you give commands? Visually, we don't have that problem here. Auditorily, we do have that problem here. Physically, we don't have that problem here. We also have, there's also vibration, right? So like I have had deaf dogs where when owners are in the other room, you would have them like bang on something. Right, and they could sort of feel that, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Or
that's part of what this dog is experiencing is all these trucks going by. They feel these vibrations out of nowhere.
You also have the e-collar, which goes on the vibrate, which is great because the vibration, you can be like, bzz, come over here, right? So that can be very helpful for you, right? So the e-collar, you know, despite people's prejudice about every aspect of every setting on it, it also has a nice vibration where you're just like, hey, can you, give it to them that way? Now, we live in Manhattan, New York. So downtown Atlanta, as much commotion as there is, that could probably be the quietest neighborhood in this city. We work with a lot of dogs that come from out of state, Puerto Rico, like you were just saying.
Mm-hmm. A lot of dogs from the rural south. Most
lot
of the
dogs from the south.
Especially rescues.
Especially near and far, there's a lot of that.
Yeah, Georgia, Alabama, South Carolina, Texas, like very rural.
A lot. And you'd be so. And when some of these dogs come here, they are freaking out. So the devil, I just said it, the devil's in the details, and there is a subtlety to this that I would have to see. And I'll explain why I'm saying that. And I'll give you some general tips that you can do, but let me explain. And this is someone who's on Patreon, and this is a rescue person. I would happily, I've done so many of
chat
these through FaceTime,
yeah.
And I've done these, yes, plenty of times. So I had this one recently, this fantastic, these two owners, these two guys got this dog. It was from some island. I can't remember, but it was some island. I'm actually trying to remember, but I can't. Beautiful pit mix. They, during COVID, they were staying in Cape Cod or somewhere really nice and rural and beautiful. They got back to New York and they're like, he's going bananas. Doesn't trust, if anybody goes to pet him, he just backs up and immediately and can't, like, and to the point where it's dangerous. Like, I was like, you have to get a carabiner and clip him to a belt, and it better be the most expensive belt that you have and the thickest one. Cause I was like, he's got that strength where if he gets out of your hand, he's just gonna flee, and there's cars everywhere, right? So there's a danger, there's a safety aspect to this, right? They had him on the front harness, but I was like, the amount of pulling he could do forward and back was making it impossible, right? So even so, out of the harnesses, I have, you know, Brutus's guy. I said everybody, I made Brutus Jewish because now he's got allergies too, right? just to keep take any pressure off, I put him on, like, I use three different.
I
use four different collars on him,
closet.
But like,
yeah.
So when he plays with his friends, I switch him from that to this, like, just depending on what he's doing, right? So they had him on the front harness, but the problem with that is because when he's walking, if anything, a door opens to a store, there's flowers outside the store and the wind blows a little bit weird. A sign outside of a coffee shop that if the wind blows, it may shift a little bit. People with hand trucks, someone running past, all the normal city stuff, a truck going by, the garbage person taking something, all these different things. What would happen is, he doesn't stay right by their side. He either juts forward. So think about it, takes three steps forward, and then he's yanking them at the front of the lead, or even worse, goes back, which is harder than behind their legs. Then when they turn, he crouches down. So you could see how quick this momentum happens, right? Anytime he's shifting forward to back, he's in a, what type of state? flight state.
Flight state.
When he's in a flight state,
which is dangerous.
It's very dangerous, but that he's having an exacerbated reaction to what's happening, right? Treats are not going to do anything because he's not taking them. He's just like, when they're nervous, their eyes are shifting. You could try to do that thing where you say their name and, like, you know, when people do the thing, they offer a treat and then they, like, you know, people do this with training all the time and it makes me crazy. They go, they move their hand like closer to the dog's nose as if they couldn't smell the treat while it's already like in your pocket, or better yet, they could still smell it in your apartment when you're a block away. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, I'm like, stop forcing the connection here. So in this scenario, that wasn't happening. So they switched to a martingale collar, and I was like, that's not good, because he's going to, even with that, with the release of pressure on that, he's going to choke himself, right? So I was like, listen, when he's speeding up like that, you have to slow him to the pace that you're at, so he learns, because otherwise what's happening, his body is communicating more to his brain, right? The threat, what's that, thoughts cause feelings, then feelings cause physical behaviors, and those physical behaviors called more thoughts cause more feelings. You understand? So now we're in a downward spiral. It's how synaptic connections work. Nerve cells that wire together fire together, and then the longer they do that, the more they get hardwired into your brain, and then your biology starts, you know, the thoughts that are causing your biology to move.
It's like dominoes. Then causing it,
it's 100% like dominoes. So I was like, so he can't jut backward or jump, but we have to keep him right by your side, because you have to communicate through the leash that you are somehow safe. Now, treats are not doing this. Nice talking to him. Nothing is doing that. So I said, listen, so I went to the soft prong or the halty. I was like, you have to do one of these two things. And I said, I gave the owner's choices. I said, the halty can work fantastic. And I would suggest that almost for this dog, right? You can go with the halty or the soft prong, because you have to keep him from jutting forward, jutting back, so he can, we can walk through these things gracefully, so his biology, his body doesn't take over and freak him out more than he's already freaking out. Now, there's variables to all this. What blocks I put him on made huge differences. The avenues are way different than the side streets, because there's that much more traffic. There's that much, if a Harley goes by, forget about it, right? Now, the other thing is that he loves other dogs. When he sees another dog, he runs right up to them and he'll start playing with them on the street. I'm like, okay, so that's a difference right there. Even though other people couldn't go near him and pet him, the second I brought Brutus out, it was like playing in the street. Like a truck would go by, he'd freeze for a second, but then go right back to it. So the influence of work, if this dog is dog friendly, the influence of being surrounded by other dogs that are friendly creates, it almost encases them. So I said, listen, don't try to push this too far too fast, because this will work itself out. I've seen this work itself out a lot. They live in Brooklyn, which is less chaotic than Manhattan. I said, listen, he was isolated to just these two people. I was like, you have to start to open his world a little bit, right? And by opening his world is, there has to be other people that he trusts, other animals that he trusts. So I said, I want you to get a dog walker, and I want you to start to do the things. You have to monitor his thresholds, right? And this person works at a shelter. They know what I mean by thresholds. You have to monitor his thresholds and make sure he doesn't go over thresholds. So he's like, can I bring him to Manhattan and you work with him? Every time he goes to the gym every day here in Manhattan, I go, I was like, I wouldn't do that, because I think Manhattan is a little bit too much, which downtown Atlanta is not going to be like Manhattan. I've been there. So I said, that's too much. Start in Brooklyn where you are. Consistency. I would have this dog walker come, instead of once a day for an hour, I would have this dog walker come 3 times a day for 20 minutes. And so now I checked in with them. I'm like, how is this going? They're like, he's making huge strides, which I knew he was going to. The halty was so helpful, or they go back for it in the halty or the soft prong. That's up to them, but they both serve the same purpose, because it wasn't allowing his body to, like, it wasn't allowing him to shrink. Right. That's the word I'm looking for, shrink, right? It wasn't allowing, it was like a kid, if you have a kid and he's terrified of something, you take, what do? You take him by the hand and you walk him through that thing with a secure hand and you assure him that they're safe. And if you have other children around him to buffer that space a little bit that he trusts, that he likes. And for the most part, larger dogs help with this, right? Because they physically, you know, a big boy like Brutus is going to, that's what he's here for, is going to help him with this. Now, the only difference with this dog, death is not so much of a factor with this. I understand that because this dog's deaf, it's harder to communicate and soothe vocally. But let me ask you a question. If this dog wasn't deaf and now we added all the sounds of downtown Atlanta, how much worse do you think this would be?
Oh, gosh.
Right?
Yeah.
So but the one challenge with if a dog's deaf, perhaps this dog's confidence isn't as high because they haven't been taught the commands that they've been taught. So teaching commands, like you can use the e-collar on vibrate just to use the prompt. Of course, you have to know how to adjust dogs to that so that this new vibration doesn't freak them out. But you could learn that in 10 seconds on YouTube. But giving this dog a full set of commands so that you raise their self-esteem, having them around other animals that they trust, continually walking like that, and they should adjust. Deciding where you are that's going to touch the problem with not putting them over threshold is important too. That's what a lot of people do. They put too much weight on the bar too soon. But you have to get to the other side of this.
Absolutely.
People have to get to the other side. And here's another thing that I've done. So I've had dogs that won't pee. And this person's vet, this is going to be up to their vet. I don't know what this dog's medical condition is. I never want to give medical advice. So we had, you know, Jeannie.
Yes.
Okay.
Of course.
So one of the people who works with our charity rescued this dog, Shadow, years ago. She's passed, but I raised her with my dogs, right? She was terrified of outdoors, would never pee on the pavement. So what we did was we took it to the vet and they took the saline, the water injection. You know when your dog's dehydrated?
Yes.
Or they have, so they put the big saline injection in the back of their neck, so mm-hmm. it looks like a camelback.
Mm-hmm.
So we took her to the vet. They filled her. She would not pee outside. They filled her with a huge amount of the water on her back. She was just hydrated. And then I kept her outside until she peed. And then she peed. And then she peed again because I took her to the same spot the next day. Mm-hmm. And then she peed again. I found an area that was a reasonable place that she would pee. It was a patch of grass, like with a tree sticking out of it, surrounded by all the normal New York stuff,
right,
like the goddamn barbed wire, like it's a, you know, like it's a prison camp. Like, and I was like, yep, well, I'm letting her jump in there. And that consistency helped her a little bit. Right.
Yeah.
And if same thing, if they're peeing, if this dog's like peeing in the house, like you sop it up, if it's right outside the house, but even sitting right outside of on the porch of the house, or if it's a building, like sitting right outside, letting people come in and out, you got to do some exposure. The other thing is this: fast movement is your friend. So there's the West Side Highway here, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm going to move on to the next question, but this is important. Okay. I've had tons of dogs that are terrified of being outside, terrified in the streets of New York. However, and I learned this, I think I learned this like 15 years ago, when it was like one of the first dogs I worked with this. The dog park here is on the West Side Highway, which is probably it's a highway, and then there's a high fence in the dog park. I noticed that a lot of those dogs were terrified, but then when they got in the dog park, they were a lot better, or they were okay, because they were running around playing. I'm like, okay, well, what's taking the priority that's now making them ignore these sounds of these trucks?
What's overcompensating for the fear?
What's overcoming it, right? What's now the fun that they're having despite the fact that that boogeyman is right over their shoulder? I was like, because they're having so much fun in the dog park, right? I was like, but I can't take every dog to the dog park because not every dog's appropriate for the dog park. Sometimes I don't want to go. So what I started doing, I was like, I would take dogs on bike rides, and I would take them, and there's a bike path on the other side of the West Side Highway where it's close enough exposure. When they're running like, I would take them with another dog that's stable, or take them for jogs. When they're running like that and moving forward, and they're moving so quickly with you, these things they're processing are going by so quick that it's a lot easier way to adjust them, because they're not just sitting there like, you think about it. They look at something, they back up, they pin on it. They're like, wait, what is that? It's going by so quickly and you're moving them so fast that they can't really scurry backwards because they're already scurrying forward with you. So these are all little tips and little tweaks that you somehow have to figure out where the magic button is. And sometimes there is none. Sometimes you're like, you know what? This dog's just never going to be that great in that apartment. Shadow was never great in the city. They had a farm upstate, but she was tolerable. We wanted to get them to the point of manageability. So that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to move the needle as much as possible and use all the techniques available. And if a dog is, and I'm sorry, if this dog's like, you know, if people are doing a thing where it's like, well, she's halting. So they're like, come on, come on. And she's not hearing you say this, obviously, but they're like, come on, come on. And then there's resistance on the harness and they're frozen. It's called a hot spot, not like the one on their bodies, but they're just sort of frozen there. And you're expecting them to be able to get themselves to take those first few steps, and we're just using treats. If that's not working really quickly, you got to move on to the next thing. which means like switch the collar out, go to something, like you've got to get their bodies moving, because when they're sitting there stuck in their own thoughts like that, the worst thing people could do is sort of adjust their body. You know, I'm not saying like grab dogs and yank them out of there. Of course I'm not saying that. But when it came to this dog, Captain, and it's got to be hundreds of dogs that I've worked with this. It's like, you got to get those bodies moving. You can't wait for them to agree with you when they're in a panic state. Because how are they going to get to the other side?
They're never going
to
snap out of it on their own.
No.
It's the same with people. People can't snap out of it. Like if you're in the middle of worrying about something or having an anxiety attack, or you're in a heated moment with your partner or with a coworker or God knows what, it's that same thing. You can't just snap yourself out of it. That's not how that works.
And you also have to see, right? People have to come up to, they have to think. They have to think very logically, and if they have a small box of training style that they think out of, they have to get out of it. How many people would say this? How many people would be like, wait, this is a scared dog and you're putting a prong collar on him? Like, so when we used both, right? And I said to the owners, you have to use what you're comfortable with using and what he's comfortable with. It's like, so the Halsey, he was like going at it, and when we used the prong, it was like, he just couldn't get the momentum of, he couldn't get stuck in the mud, and he couldn't get the momentum of running ahead. And they were able to now walk him in a way where he was a lot more piecemeal, and that piecemeal walking style allowed him to just flow a little more, like float. Right. So like, you have to find the trainers who know how to do this, not who want to be able to do the best they can. You got to do better than that. Make sense?
No, absolutely.
I'm giving it to you real. Okay.
Okay, so this next one is from Nathaniel. Just found out that there's a dog park near my house. Oh, here we go again. Never been to one before. What are some general do's and don'ts for a first-time dog parker? That's a great question.
It is a great question, but every city, every dog park is different.
Of course.
When I was in LA, I was like, this is heaven on earth. When I'm here in New York, I'm like, this is hell on earth, right? I think, the problem with dog parks in New York, I don't like the concrete surface for large dogs like this. It's right. Like, especially when they play like Brutus does, because their legs splay out. So some people, that's a concern. For other people, it's not. Different times of the day, there's different energies in there. Some dog parks, people think it's okay to bring a lot of intact males, especially, it's not that it's a major no-no. You better be aware of where those dogs are, how other dogs are going to be. You have to know a lot, because you don't want to just be like a sheep amongst other sheep in terms of like your thinking in there.
I meant major no-no in the sense of like, at some point,
most of the time,
I believe it's on the owner. And it is rare that I have seen an owner with an intact dog. It's like if you have a kid that loves to just like run around and like, gets really aggressive with other kids. Like I know a lot of parents that are like, oh, I got to keep an eye on, so-and-so. But I see a lot of owners that don't really have a sense of wherewithal.
Correct.
With their dogs.
That's the major point, is like you have to understand that the dog park energy is going to be dictated by the dumbest person in there.
Correct.
And by the most careless person in there. And you have to know how to navigate that.
Right.
Now, by the way, and what Kristin is saying, and I know she she'll agree with me, we're not saying that that intact males are the ones that are being aggressive. It's the way a lot of dogs react to them.
Correct.
It's the way
other dogs react to intact males. It's like something has just sucked all the air out of the room.
And it's not always. I've seen intact males in the dog park, and it's like it would take a very skilled eye to understand the difference.
Yeah.
But I'm talking 9 out of 10 times.
Yeah,
right?
I was about to say.
Nine out of ten times.
At some point we do get to say like it's often
it's
that this
yeah.
happens.
Everything I'm saying is guys not gossip, but I'm telling you my experience, and it's a lot. So you have to know how to read the dog park. If there's hyperactive dogs in there that are the play feels too rough for you and uncomfortable. If the space is too small and there's tight pockets, if there's people just sitting on their cell phone on the bench, it's like, that's the last thing. If people have dogs on their laps and they're petting them, and you can tell they're petting them because those dogs are nervous, you can be assured that when other dogs come and sniff them, the dog on their lap is going to be in a protective manner and snap at those dogs, right? And so, if people are giving out lots of treats, there's so many variables. So what I do is this. I tight pockets are another thing. When when play style, when you're in a smaller dog park and the play gets too, like a lot of dogs on one or the pockets get really tight, I always go, come on, disperse, disperse, disperse. I keep it moving around. I don't want tight pockets because here's what happens. Play styles, like it's like kids. They're playing. It's like if they're wrestling in a small room, like someone's elbow is going to hit someone in the face. And then with dogs, what happens is they don't realize that the other dog was just playing. Like when play gets too excited, then it starts a fight. And it starts a fight. Why? It didn't need to. The other thing is there has to be a level. Like I have a volume knob that I'm like, I don't allow play over 7. I mean, when it's one-on-one play dates with Brutus and his friends, I'm like, they can go crazy. I'll let them work it out, right? But in the dog park, a lot of time, just like kids playing in the basement, when they're play wrestling, how quick does play wrestling turn into like real wrestling? It turns into a real fight. It happens all the time.
And it's almost always triggered by because one person accidentally got too aggressive and the other person interpreted of like, oh, we're doing this now.
Right. They interpret.
And then that was it.
Right. And like, listen, when I'm in the dog park, right, my head is spinning. I'm like, I'm watching everything, right? So I read the park. I see who's in here. I'll see sometimes like, you know, small dog park, someone's got little, like 3-year-old kids running around and playing in there. It's like, this is like, not that kids shouldn't be allowed in those parks, but I see like the parents, they're just letting their kids do that. Well, what if some of the dogs get triggered by kids in there? Like that's highly, you
and
have
there's
to.
There's no way to know until they're already in there.
If I see, I'll see dogs playing tug of war in the dog park, and they're playing, and people are like, oh no, it's okay. They're
that's
just playing.
That's the other
and
thing then, is toys in the dog park that can.
If
sometimes,
there's a lot, sometimes if there's a lot of the same ones, but here's my point: is like the way you and I are thinking about this is the way everybody should be thinking about this because over COVID, right? A dozen. I've pulled a dozen dogs off of other dogs in the midst of fights when their owners are going just screaming as if they didn't know what happened.
Right.
And you could have, and I could tell you, and you've seen, and I'm not being cocky here at all. I swear on my dog's life, I'm not being cocky here. How many people, when we're in the dog park, they go, Justin, do the thing where you tell us exactly what's going to happen. Right?
Right.
And I go, watch. I go, these two, right? You can see it
can
5 minutes
it.
Before anything's going to happen. You can see how these two dogs
you
are related.
Read their body
you can
language.
See when this one's pestering this one too much. You can see when the owner is just sitting there and they're going, when they walk in carrying their dog because it's their dog's first time on the park or they keep him on lead. And then the other dogs are jumping up to say hi because that's what they do. And then the owner starts raising their voice. And then that other one just, you can see these things because when you learn dog behavior, nothing taught me more than when I was walking dogs. And all the trainers I know who are really, really good, they all walk dogs first. A lot of them walk dogs first. You learn the most. And when I would go to the dog parks on the weekends, the same dogs that were walked together in packs and were friends together with dog walkers, I'd watch those dogs get into fights on the weekends. Why? Because a lot of the owners weren't doing the job of policing the park the way they should. And so the dogs were just doing that job. And how do dogs do that? What do they have available to them? They have their teeth.
They have their mouth.
So I'm not saying dog parks are not great places. I loved going to the dog parks in LA. There are cities that have fantastic dog parks, but there are also cities where the owners are slightly more educated than other ones. So you want to, and you always have to go with your comfort level. If you're like, you know what, right now this feels uncomfortable for me, then you come back again the next day. Even when I'm doing training sessions with dogs that like, if they don't know each other and their body language to me, I'm like, I just don't know what this means. Not that I don't know what the body language means. I'm like, let's take our time. When I introduce Brutus to some of my dogs who are a little bit going to be turned off by his play style, right? They may jump into a play bow, but then I was like, well, what if he plays too hard? I'm like, let's just take our time. Like my comfort level has to determine how fast we go. And so this person's, Nathaniel, your comfort level has to determine how fast you go. And you can also go for 5 minutes, see how you feel. If something overwhelms you, then you leave. Then you can come back another day. But you just have to be educated as a dog owner. And educated dog owners are going, trust your instincts. Trust your instincts.
Well, speaking of that, and just to kind of give this a little bit more of a bullet point, is because you are so knowledgeable. So
something.
For someone like myself, that was all great information, but that was also a lot of information and
a lot
of storytelling. So I'm just going to kind of pull it back for a second.
Sure.
And I'm going to genuinely ask, if you are like Nathaniel and you are a first-time dog park person, give me three potential things
yes
that are I won't say red flags,
sure,
but like behaviors. Like one of the biggest things I've always seen is people don't know when the difference is of when dogs are mouthing at play, mm-hmm, and then when that's about to turn nasty. So give me your top three things to watch for.
If when you walk in, the energy level feels too rough for you, then that's not a good time to be there. That would also be synonymous with too crowded, right? Too crowded. Okay. Number two, have a level of comfort, play comfort for your own dog, because you have to be responsible for your own dog, that have the level that you're comfortable with at the most. For me, it's 7. When they start playing too rough or it gets above a 7, I call them back to me, put them on leash, give them a little minute, and then I let them go back to it. Number three, avoid dogs that are playing with toys that are those dogs' toys, because you don't want to deal with any possessiveness. And I'll give you another one. Try to not hand a bunch of treats out when you're in there. And I'll give you something. If dogs are shy...
A lot of people make that mistake all the time.
And if your dogs are shy in the dog park, the best thing for you to do is not sit on the bench and comfort them. Go play with the other dogs and lead by example. Because if they see you playing with the other dogs, they'll be more interested
in the
other dogs.
Then they
know those
guys are okay.
Yes. That's it. Okay, you're right. That took a long way to get around to.
That was great, though. That's what I'm talking about. Like, that's... See, I learned... You know, it took me a long time to learn from that stuff. Because you know me. Like, you know, Italian Jewish mother. I'm like, I came with all the stuff for all the dogs. And then that was a big mistake. Okay. The next one is from Becca. Our 14-month-old blue heeler, Charlene...
That's a dope name.
That's a great name. Barks at the other dogs in the hallway of our building. We say quiet in a really positive voice and try to distract her with treats, but she will just grab the treat and run to the door, keep listening and waiting for the next noise. As the day goes on, the intensity gets worse and worse. I know we aren't doing this right. Help.
Yes, you are not doing this right. I don't think Charlene knows what quiet means, and you have to direct her. She's alerting you, right? I'm going to make this very easy. Go watch the doorbell drill on YouTube that I put up there.
Yes.
When dogs bark at
someone's
the door.
Someone's here.
Just go watch it.
There's someone out there.
Go watch it, right? She's just alerting you and letting you know, so you have to direct her to what you want her to do next, and you have to do it constructively, and you have to give her words of meaning and value because she's asking you what to do. Just going quiet... It's like, that's not addressing what she's asking. And distracting with treats isn't going to do anything. Here's what's happening. She's letting you know someone's there. You're saying something that, and if you're saying it very positively, it probably to her sounds like, good girl, right? And then you're waving a treat and then giving it to her. So basically, that's how the rep is closed. There's been no, you haven't asked her to make a choice to do something else. So
it's like when I go to Colin, I'm like, Colin, right, please stop that.
Right.
Like he would be like, what?
So distracting does nothing in any scenario. What you want to do is channel them to make another choice and do something constructively, and you want to explain, and I'm going to make this one quick because I've done this question so many times. You want to explain to them like, oh, thank you for alerting me. Here's what I want you to do now. Go to your spot, sit, stay, count the 1, 2, 3, reward, go to the door, open it up so that they desensitize, finish the rep. You've heard me do this 100 times and it's so simple. Just to watch me teach this on YouTube, if this dog is obviously treat motivated because they can distract her with a treat. You can do it with toys. You can do it with affection. But if you're not bringing them to a set of commands that teach them something constructive to do with the information that they're getting from the environment, then all you are doing is treating them for reacting to the environment. And she is doing nothing wrong. What kind of dog was this? Oh.
A heeler.
Sure. Okay. So
this is what they do.
Of our building, which means we have a hunting dog in a building.
Right.
And there's quite a positive... And there's other animals outside the door.
Right.
Right? What is she supposed to do?
Exactly.
Okay. Here we go.
You seen that thing that made the rounds on social media?
What?
Where it's like, hey, what's your name? And the dog goes, Tony. And he's like, F you, Tony.
Yeah.
What's your name? Ezekiel. F you, Ezekiel. Like, it's so... Love it. Okay. This next one is from Mitch and Craig. Okay. Hi, guys. Thank you for all the helpful tips. We practice the big 6 for about 10 minutes off and on throughout the day. with Wendell, our rescue shepherd Rottweiler mix.
Aw. Oh, that's
and
be a
this
beauty.
Stuff really works. We walk him on a combo of the prong, martingale, and front lead harness, like you mentioned in one of your IG lives. And it's like having a Swiss Army knife for all the different scenarios we encounter. This dog is happy and gaining confidence because he's so proud as we praise him for a great job while he's learning and following our commands out and about in LA.
Ah, I'm coming to visit.
Oh boy, he's on a plane. There we go. Now the bad news. Our neighborhood is one of those fireworks all summer hoods. Oh, I lived in one of those. Mm-hmm. He heard the first boom the other night and lost his shit. He ran into the corner and cowered. We tried to soothe him, give him treats, play with him, but it's as if he saw the devil. We're really nervous because we know there's more to come. Anything we can do to get ahead of this is so greatly appreciated.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Fireworks are the bane of my existence.
Every dog owner.
Not every dog owner. Listen to me. I've adjusted dogs to fireworks with exposure, and then I've had it backfire on me. I mean, pun intended. The best thing you can do for this, right, is while the fireworks are going on, I always tell people, like, you got to make it like almost like a party, right? Now, this is so not foolproof that as good as I can do this, I've never mastered this because some dogs' reactions to this are just... I had Pacino so well adjusted to fireworks, and then when we were in L.A., we were in a firework, nonstop neighborhood, and he had cancer, and I was like, I was like, this is what's going to kill him. It drove me nuts. So the way I do it is like, listen, if there's places where while there's the fireworks, you could take them out for jogs, do things that are really fun so that, like, you know, they hear the fireworks in the neighborhood, but you're out running. So like I said, just like I said
good,
with the other dog.
Get those good chemicals going in their brain.
And you're moving and doing something. I would also do, like, when the fireworks started, I'd make it like up. I would play really big games with him that, like, they can play, like, real rough or play, like, really physically engaged, right? So if your dog loves fetch and you know, outside the back of your house, like, while the fireworks are off, you can start playing fetch with them. Anything, just the same exact thing I just said about the dog park on the West Side Highway. Like, if your dog has friends or buddies that they, like, set play dates up while those fireworks are going on, I would play tug with them in the house, and I would bang things, like, just while I was playing tug, so they got used to big, loud, banging sounds. I'd crank the music up while we were doing it. I was basically like, big, loud noises are not going to hurt you. That's what I was trying to communicate. I know people who, you know, they make all the herbal things, like Scout's Honor makes the calming chews, right? I've seen very, very limited results with any of that. Like, if dogs are freaking out and people give them, like, a Benadryl or a Trazodone, then it's not the level of freaking out that we're talking about here. You understand? The other thing is, so the more you're kind of like, hey, make it a fun time while those fireworks are happening so that they desensitize to it. It's almost the exact same thing I just said about that dog park. Great. But let me tell you the truth here. With Pacino, that's exactly what I did, and it worked like a charm. We used to go down the Jersey Shore, and they would have fireworks on the weekends.
Remember.
We would sit out there with him. He'd be at a barbecue. He'd watch the fireworks because he could see them. And I was like, great. I have dogs that are not afraid of the fireworks because I exposed them to it. And then it just flipped one day, and he was like, you know what? I'm not having this, because it was a lot of frequency, a lot of consistency, and I sure know how to work dogs through this kind of stuff. And so you know what I did? I was like, okay, 5 o'clock is the time when the fireworks start, and I would be like, you're going to doggy daycare. And I would take him, and I would take him either to a friend's house and have a play date over there, and I'm talking about the kind
just
of doggy daycare.
Remove him from the environment.
I was like, we're getting out of this environment right now, because too much stress of that is not good for them. And I hate neighborhoods that do this, because I'm like, well, don't you care? You know, there's animals and babies and kids like that. It's like, it's okay, 4th of July. It's okay for a week afterwards. I get it. But those firework nonstop neighborhoods, I was like, I couldn't deal with it.
We had this with Suki. We lived in Harlem on 115th and Frederick Douglass. And it was the same. It's all summer. The kids have the snaps. Then they're doing, like, the, you know, like, all the different stuff. And this was back in 2009.
Yeah.
And so what we did with is we noticed that they typically went off between like 8 o'clock at night and midnight.
Uh-huh.
And so what we did was, and that was especially on Friday nights, Saturday nights, and Sunday nights. And so we would take Suki in the afternoon and we would tire her out. And then I would give her, put her in the bedroom because we were in a small space, on as far away from the windows mm-hmm. as possible. I would turn on the air conditioning, which right. was loud, and turn the TV up and give her a calming chew. And by like 9 o'clock, she would go to sleep. And so she would open her eyes and sort of look around. But I would just lay in the bed with her those 3 nights a week mm-hmm. all summer. So if she got picked her head up and like looked around, mom's right here. I'm right here
yeah.
because we didn't. And then to your point, we would just like try to get out of Dodge like most of New York does as much as we could on the weekends.
Yeah.
But it was every single weekend.
Listen, the combination of all those things, right? This is like I've adjusted dogs to this, right? And that is the way to.
But they change, is your point. They change as they get older and you never know.
Some do, some don't. Chiquita could have cared less for the rest of her life. But I'm saying like if it doesn't work, you're not doing anything wrong.
Correct.
That's what I'm saying. You're not doing anything wrong right. if it doesn't work. Just so, but that's the way to do it. Play games with them. I would play tug with them. I'd make it like, come on, let's have a lot of fun while this is happening. And I would also adjust them to loud noises when the fireworks went. I would take books.
Desensitization.
Right? And while I was playing tug, I would slam the book on the table. And then you'd see them cower. And then I'd be like, come on. And then I start. And then eventually it was like, they stopped caring about loud sounds. And I would give them like, And the other thing is, like, I would see it start to bend a little bit in the beginning where it was, like, then they started to care less and less. Then I would put, like, I would also put firework. You could put fireworks on YouTube, and I would turn it up.
Oh, that's a great idea.
I mean, YouTube wasn't big as, but I would find, like, fireworks, something fireworks, right? You can get, like, I actually had, like, an audio thing. Like, I had effects. You know, because I worked in voiceover also. So I had like effects soundtracks and I would play on my stereo. I would play like fireworks and play with them while they were hearing that to desensitize them to it. So if you do all those things and it starts to work, that's great. But if it doesn't, it's not because you're doing it wrong.
Right. Yep. Right. Okay. So the next one is from Kathy.
Let's make this the last one because we ran a little wrong. We'll answer this person's last next week.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Kathy. Oh, let's do Kathy. Yeah, let's do Kathy. I'm not even going to edit this, everybody. You're going to hear us feeling it out.
Oh,
we got
boy.
Questions from Vancouver next week.
So this one's from Kathy. Hi, Justin and Kristin. Thank you so much for the last episode where you talked about no one-size-fits-all approach to training. You're relating it to teaching your son drove it all home for me. Oh, you're welcome, Kathy. I was driving myself nuts on the internet with the conflicting do's and don'ts because it's all so black and white. I want to get a professional trainer for my beagles, Sherlock and Matilda.
That's awesome.
That is very good.
Nailed.
Because they are high-drive dogs who are very vocal. We live in Florida. How do you suggest I approach vetting a trainer that's not too heavy-handed or too soft is the word I want to use? Or should I just buy both plane tickets?
Or should I just buy you both plane tickets?
Buy you both plane tickets?
That's sweet.
Nice.
That's sweet.
That's very sweet.
So
I'll come for free, Kathy. My family lives in Florida.
There you go. Soft is not the word, but I know what she means. She's like, she doesn't want somebody
right.
who's like, she doesn't want someone who's going to be too coddling, and she doesn't want someone who's going to be too harsh. And I agree with that. Like,
especially with beagles.
Anything. I mean, like, listen, balance training to me is the way to go.
Absolutely.
Right? It's the way it's they have to have an understanding of the four quadrants of operant conditioning. Corrections should not be abusive in any way, shape, or form, but there should be a aspect of the word no and limits and discipline because everybody learns that way. Trainers should have a full knowledge of all the different forms of equipment, and if you ask them, like, you know, what tools they use, they shouldn't just give you, well, we use these. It shouldn't just be just one. They should know how to use all different things. They shouldn't demonize any form of equipment because of a lack of knowledge or use of them or improper use of them, right? And they shouldn't have a one-size-fits-all approach and say, well, here we only use e-collars and prong collars. Like, well, how do you know that's right for that dog? Or someone who's like, well, here we only use harnesses because we think those you definitely don't want those either. You want somebody who knows their way around all these things that can make the right choices for your specific dog. Now, when you're teaching basics, right? I assume this person's learning basics.
Yes.
How wrong can you go here? If you're teaching dogs to sit, you're teaching dogs to stay. The answer is you can go pretty wrong, because people have to have understandings of reward schedules, how to phase treats out, how to use different forms of rewards like affection, play, toys. They have to know all those things. So what I always tell people to do is speak to other dog owners who have dogs that behave the way your dogs want. And that have dogs that are similar in terms of temperament and have goals that you want. And ask them who they used. And see how consistent those dogs behave with those things. And see if the methods that they're practicing are things that you agree with. And also, there's a lot of different people you can talk to. You can also, if you have a specific issue, what I tell people to do is I'm like, ask for references. Be like, listen, I'm sorry. Yes. I don't mean this. Like, ask them. Be like, I'm not trying to discredit your value or make you feel that you're not, you know, because a lot of trainers can get sensitive. I would get sensitive about this. You know, when someone's like, well, okay, I get sensitive about certain things that certain people say in emails with us. You know what I mean? But ask them, be like, hey, I'm dealing with this issue. This is what I want to learn. Can I speak to someone who had an experience with you so I can just sort of see how they felt about it? They shouldn't have a problem doing it. If someone asked me for references, I'd be like, here's 100 of them. Go ahead. But most everything comes from referral for me. We don't advertise at all. Like, everything comes from referral, and I'm so exposed in the media and things like that. It's like, you know, you'd have no problem researching what I do, right? Also, really good trainers, they have material on Instagram. You should see them working, right? You'll see stuff that they do. And by seeing the stuff they do, you'll see the dogs they work with. They're going to tag those other dogs. So just learn about them a little bit. And I mean, there's a reason this person is asking this question. And I have to assume if Kathy lived in New York, I have a feeling I know who she'd be calling for dog training, right? So there's probably great trainers in Florida like that. But I never want to go with the people who are like, we train this way.
Correct.
I like the people who are like, our approach is effective with different types.
It's a constellation.
Yeah, and ask them what their experience with beagles have been like, and ask them if they're like, you can ask them. You say, well, if they say like, you know, we only use these type of collars, be like, well, I don't know, I'd like to learn about those collars and see if there's other ones in your toolbox. I was gonna say armamentarium, but why am I doing that? Other ones in your toolbox that might be better for my dog. Are you open to that? And if they go, well, we use what we use. Okay, then no, that's not it.
Well, also, and Kathy, this is an investment. It's a financial investment. Oh. As Justin has said multiple times, it's not cheap. So it's a financial investment, and it's an investment in the manner in which you are going to be able to properly and effectively communicate with your dogs. So anytime that you are about to spend good money, you should ask for references.
Yeah,
I don't care if it's a doctor. I don't care if it's a trainer. Like, I don't care if it's a babysitter, whatever that is. You should always ask for references, people, no matter what. And I know that that's why you support that.
Yeah. And, you know, people have also sent me websites of other trainers. I don't go by if someone's like, I'm certified by this or that. I'm like, I don't think those mean anything. I mean, like, you know how many times people there's certified trainers that are fantastic. There are also that are worth shit. You know what I mean? I told the story about the dentist all the time I went to. He was like, you know, this award-winning dentist and screwed my tooth. It's like, that doesn't mean anything. It's like, you want somebody who's got... Anybody could go to school to learn how to do something and then open a business. Anybody can do that. You want somebody who has a touch, who really has a touch. And it's like, so, you know, that's the way I think of it. And the other thing is, like, what I tell people is, like, beware of big packages. If someone's like, well, you have two beagles here, here's a 10-pack, I'm like, then I'm like, if these are dogs that need to learn, like, when we teach the big six, I say, like, if you have a puppy that you don't know anything, it should take me about 3 sessions to get you through that big six. Now, if someone did it in 5, would that be unreasonable? And if there's two dogs and they're like, listen, we'd like to train the dogs separately. If it was like 6 or 7, but it was like, if someone's like, here's our 15-package thing, I'm like, no. That's way too big. I'm like, you know,
I agree.
My dog would be doing red algebra.
Red flag. Right. Exactly. Right. So my dog can now fix my toilet.
And by the way, with people, I go like this. They go, are there packages available? I don't ever sell packages until I meet them. I go like this. I go, let's do one. Let's see how you feel. And then let's assess what we think your dog will need going forward. And if we think you're going to want a handful of these, we'll come up with a rate together that's comfortable for you. You know, they should feel generous. They should feel like a generous person who cares about you and cares about your dog. You know?
Exactly.
That's how I feel about it. That's me. I'm only talking for how I run my business.
No, but as someone who's had to hire trainers as well, you know, for some of the, you know, the dogs that I definitely couldn't train on my own, I think that that's all very, that's all very well in standard.
Yeah. And you don't need, listen, if someone comes to me with like, hey, we have two puppies, it's like, I tell them, like, you don't need me. You don't. I'm like, you know, I have Ebony who I work with. I have other trainers. I go.
I know a lot of people that have come back to me and been like, well, I talked to Justin and he said that.
I just think I'm too much bang for the buck. I'm like, listen, if someone's like, listen, we adopted this dog.
And then they come back and they act like they've just gotten rejected on Tinder. No, they're like, he said he couldn't help me.
No, it's not that I can't. It's like, if you just need to learn some puppy bit. Like, there's people I'll do it with, but it's sort of like, if this is just sort of like pain, if this is very simple 1, 2, 3 stuff, and it's like, you're like, listen, I want my dog to. If someone wants the big six, I could teach very quickly, but it's like, I don't do it with everybody because it's like on my priority, the last thing, the first thing are the dogs that really need behavior modification. That's what I like to do first. The basic sort of like the things that a lot of other trainers can do, I'd refer them to other people that are also and can like have more availability and have more time. Like, this person will do great by you and then come back and then I'll do the heavy lifting. Exactly. When I was in LA, I gave a bunch of clients to other people. And then when I came back, they're like, this person was great. We learned a lot. We kind of want to refine it with you now. No problem. No problem. All right. We've ran a little long. Kristin, I love you to death. Thank you so much. Wait, I love you to death.
I love you.
Okay. Thank you guys so much for submitting your questions. Again, it's patreon.com/TLOD. I also sometimes field some of these questions from Instagram and the other places, but this is the place where I can really like sort of sit there and like really take it in and look at it. Again, please follow us on social media at The Language of Dogs. You can leave a 5-star rating and review if you like the show, or a 4, not a 1. Until next week, everybody, happy dog training.